Hi, I'm Will, and this is the first video in my Introduction to Nix and NixOS series. In this series, we're going to go through how to build a NixOS system and how to set things up and take advantage of some of the advantages of the technology. If you're interested in the installation video, you can skip to the next one. Otherwise, keep watching this video and I'll go over some of the theory of some of the technologies involved and some of the advantages of NixOS. Okay, so the first thing we're going to cover is Nix. Nix is a package build system, primarily, where you give it a whole bunch of build files and it'll then generate a package on the other side. Now, you might think this is unremarkable because pretty much every Linux distribution has this, but the reason why Nix is such an interesting system is it focuses on basically creating reproducible builds. Now, what this means is I could build the package on my machine and somebody on the other side of the world could build the same package and they'll basically be the same, byte for byte. The reason for this is it basically generates an isolated environment which contains just the files that it needs to do the build. So ahead of time, it has to basically get a whole list of inputs to say we need disk compilers, we need these build files and whatnot. And then it builds it in a completely isolated container, which has no access to the internet, and it doesn't even have access to other folders on your system other than what's passed into it. There's a lot of advantages to doing this. Main advantage is, you'll get exactly the same package every time, which goes into the Nix store. But it also means that if the hash is the same as what's in the central cache repository, rather than building the package, you can just download the binary cache and it'll be exactly the same. This brings us to the next part of Nix is all the files it generates goes into the Nix store. This is like a central repository where it's got like hashed packages from things that it generates, which means that if you say have multiple packages that require the same dependencies, they'll all reference the same location on the disk, which is nice. But it also means that if you have the same version of a product but you've applied a patch to it, it'll get a different hash, so therefore it'll have a different location in the Nix store, which means you can have multiple versions of the same thing, or also multiple versions of the same thing, the same version, but with a different patch applied, and they'll all live happily on the same system, which is really, really cool. The final thing about Nix that I'll cover in this short introduction is Nix packages, which is like a central repository. Has thousands upon thousands of applications in, which is really, really cool. And they're also really up to date because there's like a bot that basically keeps a lot of it up to date. So in some cases, these packages are actually even more up to date than Arch, which is really cool sometimes. But the other thing that's nice about Nix packages is it's not just limited to NixOS, which means you can deploy stuff to other Linux distributions with that. And you can also deploy stuff to macOS as well. So a lot of those packages will actually run on there. There is support for Windows using the Windows subsystem for Linux, but the Linux subsystem for Windows, but I haven't actually tried it, so I don't know how well that actually works. So the next step is, what is NixOS? Well, NixOS is pretty simple. It's actually a Linux distribution built on top of the Nix packaging system. So all of its software and configuration is done via Nix. Which basically means the whole entire distribution installs on your system as a single package, which sounds kind of crazy, but when you sort of see how Nix works, it actually makes perfect sense. Nice thing about NixOS is it also gives you access to Nix modules, which is sort of like a configuration sort of system that you can use, where you basically just specify like how you want the system configured. Like you can say, I want these bits of software installed, or I want to configure my window manager in a certain way, so you pass in a whole bunch of properties, and then it will compile those settings down into a package and apply it to your system, which is pretty cool. So it means configuring your system by that is very, very easy and extremely powerful, which we'll be covering in the series later on. Finally, NixOS, because it uses a Nix package to actually deploy the system, it keeps track of it in what's called a profile, which means every time you update it, it sort of increments the version of the profile and then symlinks to the latest version. The advantage of doing this is it means if you ever need to roll back to a previous install, you can basically just revert to the previous generation, which means that you're back to your system's exactly back the way it was before you applied an update. So this is really cool because it means you can tinker with your system and you can break it in all sorts of different ways, but you can always revert back really easily. And this even works if you've got an extended file system 4 partition. You don't need anything advanced like ButterFS or anything like that. But personally, I use ButterFS because it's a pretty cool file system. Cool. So the next thing I'm going to cover is, so why would you want to actually use NixOS? Because a lot of people say, yeah, it looks cool and it's got some fancy stuff, but it's a real pain in the ass to use or run. They might say, like, why would I want to use this over Arch or Gentoo, because it can sort of do similar things. So the main reasons why I'd say you probably want to use NixOS over anything else is primarily you can set your whole system up as infrastructure as code, which means you can basically create a Git repository which contains a whole bunch of configuration files that if you apply to a blank system, it'll spin that system back up to exactly the state that you've previously had it in. Also, those files you basically just modify as part of maintaining your system to change any of its settings. So you're constantly applying what's in that repository to your system. So it's like very idempotent, like a lot of other infrastructure as code technologies. Probably something I kind of compare it to would be Ansible, which I've used in the past to kind of configure systems. This is a lot nicer because the operating system kind of expects you to use a system like this to configure it. So it just seems a lot more natural. There's a lot less, edge cases and whatnot. Plus the language that you configure everything in is Nix, which is like a functional programming language. It's just a lot more flexible than like any of these YAML-based deployment tools. So if you like infrastructure as code, you'll really, really like Nix. The other thing I really like about it is it's really easy to tinker with and recover from. So you can feel free to like play around with all sorts of settings and stuff. So like, I know, for example, like you want to rip out Pulse Audio and try Pipewire or something like that. You can easily do that. It can completely trash your system and cause all sorts of issues. And then it's really easy to revert back to your previous generation and undo all the damage that you've done, which is really, really cool. So the next thing I'm going to cover is you can modify packages and add your own to the system. And now this might not seem all that remarkable, but if you've ever used a distro where there's a piece of software that's not packaged, a lot of the time you've just got to compile it from source and then just deploy it to the system and then sort of maintain it yourself. Nice thing about NixOS is you can actually generate a package using the Nix language, and it will basically treat your package like any of the other ones that are installed on the system. So if you package anything up, you can just chuck it in there and treat it like anything else that's on there, which is really, really cool. Another thing you can do is you can override bits and pieces of existing packages that are in the system. So some packages will have like properties you can set, which will change their behavior, like add support for various technologies or whatnot. But you can also override pretty much anything on it. So if you say even wanted to apply a patch to a piece of software that's in the system, you can write your patch and apply it. And it will even try and apply that patch when you do an update as well, which is really cool. So you could like permanently hack a piece of software to change it to do something else that you want. And as long as your patch works with the new versions, then yeah, you can upgrade from there, which is really, really cool. Another thing that's really cool is the development shells. So rather than installing a piece of software that's like covers the whole entire system, so like how you normally would, you install like, I don't know, Caden Live or something, you can have it installed in the development shell, which means it won't be in your path anywhere else in the system, so it'll be as if it's not installed. And then when you change into that development shell, you can have all the tools that you want in that shell loaded from the Nix store, which is really cool. So it means you can sort of compartmentalize all of your setups. So you can say like, this is my development environment for Python, or this is my development environment for C++, for example. So you can sort of segment stuff out. Or if you work with a lot of freelance customers, you could basically create separate environments for those, which is really cool. Yeah, there's like heaps of different options of like what you can do with that. It's really powerful. Those development shells aren't just limited to NixOS either. If you install Nix on a other operating system, you can use them with that as well, which is really cool. So if you're not so sure about getting started with NixOS, you could just drop Nix on your machine and have a play around with some dev shells, which is a really good use for the technology. So that will cover my first introduction to Nix. In the next video, I'll cover the actual installation process off a live CD. And yeah, we can start going through building up the system, and then we can start moving into some more advanced topics after that. So thank you for watching my first video on Nix, and please subscribe and tick the bell icon if you'd like to see more of this content. Thank you.